This is the story of Keewatin Air Flight 202. On the 24th of April 2019, a Keewatin Air Beechcraft B200 was on the ground at Winnipeg International Airport. Today they would be flying a repositioning flight, and it would be repositioned to Churchill Airport. The plane would be piloted by a captain and a captain in training. The plane had four occupants, two pilots and two nurses. The captain would be acting as the first officer, and the trainee captain would be assuming the captain's role. So from here on out, if I say first officer, I'm referring to the captain who was training the new captain. And if I say captain, I'm referring to the pilot who was being trained. On the ground, the captain calculated the amount of fuel that they'd need for their 541 nautical mile trip to Churchill Airport. The calculations told them that they'd need 2,456 pounds, or 1.1 tons of fuel. This would allow them to make the trip, divert to an alternate airport, and then fly for another 45 minutes if needed. As the first officer conducted his pre-flight inspection, he noted that the plane only had 1,600 pounds or 720 kilos of fuel. So he went off into the hangar to find a fuel technician, but there was no one. Anyway, they could not take off right now as one of the nurses was yet to arrive. So the first officer continued to prep the plane. He helped by loading bottled water onto the plane as they waited. The nurse finally arrived and they were good to go. They took off from Winnipeg at 4:39 p.m. and as the plane climbed, the first officer did the fuel calculations for the flight. The captain entered 2,456 pounds in the fuel required box and 2,206 pounds in the fuel remaining box. They were 250 pounds short of the required value. The captain informed the Keewatin Air flight coordinator that they had enough fuel for 3 hours and 55 minutes of flight, and with that, the plane climbed to its cruising altitude of 25,000 feet. That's how most of the flight went. It was fine. When they were 14 nautical miles west of Gillam Airport, their alternate airport, the left fuel low pressure warning light illuminated, the left engine surged, and the captain turned on the boost pump. He glanced at the fuel gauges, and to his shock, the gauges showed that they had 0 pounds of fuel on board. The captain asked the first officer about the fuel quantity, and right then and there, 25,000 feet above the Canadian countryside, the first officer realized what he had done wrong. He had not ordered fuel for the trip. He never fueled a plane. At 6:14 p.m., the crew declared an emergency and started an emergency descent. The weather at Churchill was on the cusp of being unsuitable for an approach, and so the decision was taken to divert to Gillam. 6:15 p.m., the left engine was now out of fuel. The crew carried out the emergency engine shutdown procedure. As the left engine windmilled, the first officer punched in the details of Gillam Airport, and the FMS displayed the track to Gillam. The captain turned right and made a beeline for the airport. They extended the landing gear in an attempt to set up a reasonable descent angle to runway 23. The area control center notified the pilots that emergency vehicles would be standing by. As the plane descended through 5,000 feet, the pilots intercepted the vertical navigation, or VNAV path, to runway 23. They retracted the landing gear to stay on the VNAV path. By 6:20 p.m., the captain was having trouble keeping the plane under control. The first officer at this point took over flying duties. As the plane broke through 2,000 feet, the pilots gained a visual of the airport for the first time. At 6:22 p.m., the plane passed through 1,300 feet ASL. The right engine lost power. They were 835 feet above the ground. The plane now ducked below the vertical path that was required to make a safe landing on runway 23. They feathered the right engine to eke out as much distance as they could from the plane. Soon, they were 530 feet above the ground, and they were 1 nautical mile from the runway. The flaps were fully extended, and the gear was down. The plane touched down on the frozen lake, and it bounced. They had enough airspeed, and so the first officer raised the nose in a last-ditch attempt to reach the safety of the runway. The plane hit the shoreline, and then skidded onto the edge of the runway. They were down, and they all made it out alive. Not one person was injured. So how did a Beechcraft B200 run out of fuel in midair? At Keewatin Air, the crews usually refuel their planes after every flight. It's not in their standard operating manuals or anything. It's just something that they do. It's done as a courtesy to the crew who'd be flying the plane next. Also, if the plane needed to conduct a medical evacuation flight, it would help the plane get airborne much faster. So sometimes you wouldn't have to refuel the plane before the flight. But on the accident day, the pilots realized that the plane needed more fuel than it had. So the first officer went to look for the fueling agent and found no one. So he left, intending to come back later. But he forgot to fuel the plane as he was busy with other activities. When the captain asked if the plane was fueled, the first officer said yes, not remembering that he had not fueled the airplane. Okay, so the plane is about to take off with less fuel than it needs. Could the pilots have caught their mistake? Yes. Both the after start checklist and the cruise checklist have items related to fuel. On the after start checklist, there's a fuel quantity check. So when they went through that checklist, the first officer asked for the fuel quantity. The captain said that they had enough fuel without checking the gauges. He just said what he always said. For the captain, it was kind of like an automatic response, a rote response. Moreover, as part of Keewatin Air's standard operating procedures, they had to scan the instruments at least once every 30 minutes, but the fuel state was not discovered during these scans. The captain, that is, the pilot being trained, was not accustomed to checking fuel gauges as part of his scans. The gauges are hard to see from the right-hand seat, as the pilot sitting in the left-hand seat would obscure the gauges. So the first officer could not check the gauges. But they still had ways to realize that they were in danger. As part of the crew's checklist, they had to do what are known as progressive fuel calculations. The pilots knew how much fuel the plane would use in each phase of flight, so the pilots could do a few calculations and see how much fuel that they should have. Comparing this value with the amount of fuel on board lets you know if there are any problems. When doing this calculation, there's a box where you fill out the remaining amount of fuel. This value is supposed to be taken from the gauges, but that's not what the pilots did. The remaining fuel box said 2,206 pounds of fuel. That was not the amount of fuel that was remaining. It's unclear where they got this number from. At 6:13 p.m. when the engine failed, it was a shock to the crew and it caught them off guard. The workload in the cockpit skyrocketed. They had to deal with the failed engine and they had to deal with the low pressure warning. This is when they made another mistake. They immediately made the decision to divert to Gillam, but they kept flying towards Churchill for another 2 whole minutes. As they dealt with the engine failure, they did not feather the left propeller. Feathering is a process by which you can change the pitch of the blades of the propeller. You can set up the blades in such a way that it does not generate a lot of drag. But they did not do that. Instead, the left propeller windmilled as they descended. This induced a lot of drag on the plane. This is why the pilots had such a hard time controlling the plane. The drag from the unfeathered propeller contributed to a rate of descent that was higher than expected. This is why they had such a hard time staying on the vertical navigation or the VNAV profile that would have taken them to runway 23. By the time they were 1 nautical mile away from the runway, the right engine failed, and at this point, reaching the runway was impossible. The last part of the puzzle is the demarcation of duties, or the lack thereof. When the emergency started, the first officer assumed that the captain was the pilot in control. Remember, the captain was the trainee pilot, and the first officer was the more experienced pilot, but as per policy, the first officer should have taken over the flying duties. After this crash, they realized that they needed guidelines on who would do what in the case of an emergency during a training flight. So, what do you think? Do you think Flight 202 would have been able to make it to the runway had everything gone right for the crew? Let me know your thoughts. Thank you for watching this episode of Mini Air Crash Investigation. If you're watching this episode on the day that it's uploaded, Merry Christmas to you. If you don't celebrate Christmas, Happy Holidays. Stay safe. I'll catch you guys next time.